birds flying high, you know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how I feel. Breeze drifting on by, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me, yeah. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me. And I'm feeling good. Fish in the sea, you know how I feel. River running free, you know how I feel. Blossom on the tree, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life for me, and I'm feeling good. Dragonfly out in the sun.
Oh, I don't know, really. I think the perception other people get is that I'm fishing all the time, you know, full-time, 6 or 7 days a week. And, you know, I've been doing it for 42 years now, so you'd have to be reasonable to sustain what you're doing with, the captures that I've had over the years and this, that and the other. But I'm nothing special. I'm just a creative carp angler, really. I'm a thinker rather than any kind of natural, decent angler. I think I use my thought process more than instinct. I have got the instinct, there's no doubt about that. You know, I can catch them when they're there, but I think my planning and my, animal cunning to try and trip the fish up is my strong point, really. But I'd rather not be big-headed or big myself up. I'm just I'm just a carp angler, so it's one of them questions that you hate that, the way you're thinking, oh my God, no, because I'm just normal.
Fish in the sea.
I'll give you an example. It's about continental fishing. I rationalise that if you're getting bites at the start of your session at night, what the hell's the point of going out with a fish finder trying to find fish in the day to fish for them when they're probably not in the feeding mode and they're in an entirely different place? You know, the fish may be up in the water just catching some rays from the sun. And so I earmark very early on that it would be a good idea to find out when the feeding time is and go and find the buggers then. So if it's 3 o'clock in the morning, out I go in the boat at 3 o'clock in the morning with the echo sounder on looking for the fish. And that's just a quick example of the sort of thing I do on the continent. It's thinking outside the box, really, that I'm quite good at. And identifying when something's been flogged to death on a water and going in with a very unusual approach. I'm quick to pick up on things as well. If I see somebody, because you're learning all the time, if I see somebody doing something unusual on the catching, I'll jump on it and absolutely rinse it out. If it's there and it looks original, and I don't know. I was quick to get on the night sights with the night vision monocular that I had, so I could find where the fish were feeding in the middle of the night again, and save myself a right load of either, because on a lot of waters they don't show themselves in the day because they're paranoid, the fish, or they've been hammered to death. So you'll find that the time when they'll start crashing is between 1 and 5 in the morning, so I make it my business to arrive at that time, use the night sights, so I'll just walk around listening for the fish, and that's caught me loads of fish. So I suppose that's cunning in a way, and it's caught me a lot of fish. And it's just a big list of things like that. You're hunting, you're fishing, but you're hunting rather than camping. you know, so I like to treat it as an exercise of, I mean, I was fishing Birch Grove, I'll give you an example there, and some of the guys in the syndicate took the piss a little bit, because in the winter it was all boards, and the fish, it was only a small water, you know, 3.5 acres, 4 acres, and the fish knew you were there instantly. If you had your buzzers turned up, you were clomping about in moon boots on the boards, the fish knew you were there. It was like, right, batten down the hatches, guys, the anglers are here. So I was walking around in slippers, and I wasn't even using buzzers in the daytime, because I was just watching the tips. You know, I had a slight kick in the rods, and I was looking for liners and that sort of thing, and that caught me loads of fish. Despite people thinking it was a joke, it caught me loads of fish. I remember Crowy being shocked at how many bites I got very quickly, like that, you know. The best ever carp I've caught, I don't know if it's necessarily the best, the biggest, was the fish I caught from the surf lake in Belgium near Maastricht last July, well, a year last July, and that was 62.6. I mean, not particularly monstrous fish by continental standards, but it meant something to me because that lake's quite a vast water. It's about 60 acres, and I think there's been a couple of fish kills in there over the years with a couple of viruses and stuff, and it's got some old characters in, and that was the biggest mirror in the lake, and a fish that I really wanted to catch. So I did enjoy that, I must say. It was called Zeus, a real old character of a fish. Sadly, it's died now. It was £73 when it died in October. So I was the last person to catch it, you know, and that was 4 or 5 months before its demise. But one hell of a fish. The difference is immense. I think a lot of guys go carp fishing for different reasons, and I think the guy that catches occasionally is just going for release from work, from the pressures of the banality of what they're doing. You know, perhaps they've got a nagging wife or a crap job where they're absolutely stressed and bored, and it's just the release of going with the mates at the weekend, and it captures a bonus. Whereas, like myself, I was obsessed by carp fishing, and some of the other guys I know that have actually achieved something with it, I guess, without sounding, you know, stupid, is they're driven. I used to, it was like a curse. I used to dream about carp fishing. I'd wake up in the middle of the night scribbling rigs down that I dreamt about. I couldn't get it out of my mind. I couldn't concentrate on anything apart from thinking about my next session and how I was going to attack it and where I was going to go and what I was going to be doing. A total obsession. I mean, beyond an obsession. It cost me several jobs. I used to get sacked on purpose when the 16th of June was coming. It bears no relation to, you know, a normal person's life. And that was me. And thank God I've calmed down a little bit. But all the guys that seem to get somewhere with it are out of the same mould. And that's what I think is the difference. You know, it's a massive obsession. It's destructive as well. It's very destructive. But what can you do? You can't stop. My lowest moment was, there's been a few. The lowest one was when the obsession I was talking about earlier, where I was totally driven, and all I lived for was carp fishing. And I got to about 30 years of age, I guess, and I realised it was a turning point in my life. You feel like an old man that you're going to be your 30th birthday. In actual fact, it's nothing. But at the time, I thought, oh my God, I'm 30. And I sat with my head in my hands, sat on a lake, thinking, what the hell am I doing here? I've spent all these years just fishing for a fish, just to take a photograph and put it back. And I looked at a lot of my mates. They'd had all these fantastic holidays abroad, all the birds they'd had big parties, and you know, in Ibiza and here, there and everywhere. And I thought, this wasn't a rehearsal. I can't have the best years of my life back from, you know, like 16 to 30. It's gone. What have I done? I put my head in my hands. I could virtually cry, you know, thinking about what it had cost me carp fishing. And I think that's why you suddenly see guys pack it in. The realisation suddenly hits them that, what have I done? And you can never put the clock back and get them years back. But there again, now I'm older, I look back and think, well, you're being silly, you know, I chose the path I did. And now I make a living from going fishing. So, you know, there's a lot of guys that have had all these party years and all the rest of it, and they're in a crap job now that they hate. So at least I've come out the other end with a smile on my face. So, you know, it wasn't all bad news. I guess that will be one of the lower moments. Fish in the sea. Oh, there's been a few, but I guess watching my kids catch the fish, really. Our guy, you know, he's a good footballer and all the rest of it. He's, you know, a good-looking lad. He's got a nice girlfriend. Everything's good for him. And it sort of makes you jealous that they've all got these mobile phones that we never had, and they can do all this texting and, you know, Facebook and everything, and have instant contact. But he's putting his fish on there, and he's dead proud of the fish he's caught. He's caught some crackers, you know. He's a quick learner. I've taught him a lot in a short space of time. Our Jamie, he's 12. His first barbel was 12 pound, and the look on his face was just unbelievable, you know. I was jealous, actually. I thought, bloody hell, 12 pound the first time out. How nice is that? From the River Dove. But the smile on his face was just incredible. And our Jade, my daughter, one thing that did make me smile, that made me very proud, and I suddenly realised she was always very girly, you know, dolls and all the rest of it, and like nice dresses and this, that and the other, makeup. And then we went to Angler's Paradise, and I had the two boys fishing with the float rods, learning how to catch roach and stuff. And she suddenly came to me, she says, okay, she says, have you got a piece of fishing line and a hook? And she says, in fact, forget that. I don't want a bloody hook. She says, just give me some fishing line. And I says, what are you doing, Jade? She says, well, you've never really bothered with me and realised that I like fishing. She says, so I want some fishing line. I'm doing it myself. And I thought, what have I done? So I says, well, yeah, let me help you. I'll get one of the other rods and we'll set it up and that. She says, no, I'll do it myself. And what amazed me was she'd never fished before. She picked up a reed, a bulrush, tied some fishing line to the end of it, made a loop, put a bunch of maggots in the lasso, lowered it in the edge without a hook, and I swear this is the truth, and was hauling golden rudd out faster than the boys could, and they were using hooks, but she was catching fish without a hook on. I was amazed. They were actually gorging themselves on the bunch of maggots and couldn't get it out of the mouth, so she was whipping them out of the water. And in the end, the boys were that amazed by what she was doing. She made them up a rod without a hook on the bulrush, and they were hauling fish out, and so were all the other kids on the lake. She got them doing something that I'd never seen before. I suddenly realised that she was an amazing natural angler, and she'd come up with this all by herself. She was only a kid. I was amazed. I was truly gobsmacked, and I've never seen out like that since. Now she's mad on carp fishing. She goes with a boyfriend, and she's a very good angler, you know. So, yeah, that's probably... Rainbow Lake in the south of France. I know it's not everyone's cup of tea and you hear about all these big fish coming out of it all the time, but when you're actually fishing there, it's so exciting. The buzz you get from anticipating, it's ridiculous. Because you know you might have a new world record or a, you know, an 85-pound common or something. And that you can't beat that. I suppose it's my time of life because I've been doing it so long. That's what you need now to get the real buzz out of it, you know, on a personal level. So I think the extra size and dimension and volume of big fish in there, it's got more big fish than anywhere else in the world, I think. So certainly for its size. So yeah, that gives me the most excitement, and I would choose there even though it's a massive drive. From a carp point of view, there's a mate of mine, a Dutch fella, and who uses my bait, and he's just been down a rainbow and he caught an 86-pound common. And what a fish that was! It was ridiculous. I looked at the photos and I thought, oh my god, that is just massive. His head looks like a peanut over the top of the thing, and he's holding it close to his body. He's not sticking it out like some people do, where they look like they've got a pair of midget hands on sticks and they've got the fish 10 feet away. He's holding it close to his body and it absolutely dwarfs him. It's just a monster. And I thought, yeah, I'd like to catch that fish. Fish in the sea. I'd have to say carp fishing, to be honest with you, because, you know, I'd survive without carp fishing. I'd just find something else to do. But the other thing, I think I'd just have to commit suicide. I've been really trying, baby, trying to hold back this feeling for so long. And if you feel like I feel, baby, then come on. I wouldn't have got myself banned 3 times so that I could have actually had a car to go fishing in. I ended up getting banned on the motorcycles and then in my car for being an idiot, driving around like a maniac and doing wheelies on motorbikes and things and speeding. So I lost 4 years basically of a key time when I was, I had quite an edge with, you know, using the single floor hook baits, and that was working brilliant. And I could have gone all over the place and spread my wings a bit, you know, and fished in the Cone Valley more and got myself around and probably have caught a ton of big fish at the time. But I got banned being an idiot. And I think I started a tackle shop in 1990 with stupid small money. And I was making my own bait to try and supplement the income from the shop. And I found that the bait I was making very quickly outsold all the fishing gear I was selling in the shop. And it got a cult following, actually. And I just wish I hadn't have done the tackle shop. I'd have just done a bait company in 1990. And I dread to think where I'd be now. You know, it's 22 years on. Bah. You know, instead of at my age now, if I'd have just focused on that, it would have been a different story. You know, I think I'd have been, you know, well established and well set up, and my life could have been different. Fish in the sea. It's hard to say really, but I think maybe some of the little innovations and input I've had into things that have shaped carp fishing a little bit, like the fluoro baits I helped to, well, I started it really, popularising them and using them in 1981, 82. Everyone used to laugh at them and all the rest of it, but now everybody just treats it as normal, you know. The mists of time, you know, it'll be looked back on and think, I wonder who started that? But, you know, it was me, genuinely. And, you know, the old chod rig or short rig, that was one of my things. The plastic throwing sticks, you know, loads of different things really. But I'm not so bothered about any of that. The thing that I'd like to be remembered for is for just being dead approachable and okay with people, you know. And hopefully a nice person. That's the main thing to me. That they've met on the bank and I've left a lasting sort of memory as being a good guy, you know. That'll do me.
Fish in the sea, you know how I feel.
Right, well, I've started the bait company. I always wanted to do that. And I've had this lingering ambition to do it that's, even though it's late in my life, I wish I'd have done it sooner. I never had the money to do it. I never had a backer or anything like that. So, you know, the time and the place to do it was much later than I wanted, but at least it's better late than never. And I've got the one shot at doing it, in my opinion. So I want to make a statement with it. And the same goes for, I've got this real hankering to do fishing clothing and sports clothing and do something spectacular with that. And I've got a few ideas on that. And that's my next project, I think. And I also have got loads of ideas that I've been sat on for years as part of my retirement fund and my legacy. And I want to do terminal gear at some stage. And that is something that, you know, I will do. I don't know when, but I will do it. And I can guarantee when I do it, I'm going to cause a little bit of a stir with these things that I've got in my head here. Just waiting. I've got the drawings and all the ideas and the dead original, and I've kept it back, and that is what I want to do. I will do.
Fish in the sea, you know.
The best spice in the world to put in your bait is fenugreek. It's incredible. Now that's a secret.
I've been really trying, baby, trying to hold back this feeling for so long. And if you feel like I feel, baby, then come on. Oh, come on. Woo. Let's get it on. Let's get it on. Get it on, sugar, let's get it on. Ooh. We're all sensitive people with so much to give. Understand me, sugar, since we got to be here, let's live. I love you.